I want to bring in CNN political analyst Jonathan Martin, the national political correspondent for the New York Times, who broke this story in the New York Times. What a story it is, Jonathan. So what more can you, first of all, tell us about this stunning news about Mitch McConnell? Because it really is pretty amazing when you think about it.
Well, Senator McConnell, I think, is fed up with President Trump, especially given what happened last Wednesday in the U.S. Capitol. Well, if you have to remember that Senator McConnell is somebody who cares deeply about the Senate and the institution of Congress. He's never wanted to be president. He's always just wanted to be Senate Majority Leader. That was his lifelong goal. In 2 days last week, President Trump basically frittered away Senator McConnell's Majority Leader status on Tuesday. And the next day, a pro-Trump mob stormed the Capitol and desecrated the building that McConnell reveres. So in a two-day span, Wolf, I think that Senator McConnell was sort of deeply hurt by what happened. And politically, if we're being totally candid, I think he sees an opportunity now to purge President Trump, get rid of him from the Republican Party, and move on, make a fresh break.
So you think if there's a Senate trial, and there almost certainly will be a Senate trial, is it at all realistic, Jonathan, to think that he's going to be the minority leader, but now still the majority leader, Mitch McConnell, could vote in favor of conviction?
Yes.
You do?
I think it's possible.
Really?
Yeah, I sure do. In fact, I think Senator McConnell sees this opening politically. I mean, I think you have to separate these two. I think he's deeply offended by what happened at the Capitol and horrified by it. And his own safety was obviously threatened along with everybody else there. But I think from a political standpoint, Wolf, looking down the road, I think he sees an opportunity here to purge the Republican Party of somebody who he believes is a force for bad, a detrimental force in the party. And if you get all 50 Democrats to vote to convict, then you need 17 Republicans. And it makes it a heck of a lot easier, Wolf, to get 17 Republicans if one of them is named Mitch McConnell.
You're absolutely right. If he votes in favor of conviction, I assume it's going to be a done deal by all accounts. All right, Jonathan, excellent reporting. You and your colleagues at the New York Times, thank you so very much. Let's discuss all of these breaking developments, and it's really breathtaking when you think about it. Our chief political correspondent, Dana Bash, is with us. Charles Ramsey, who was the D.C. police chief and later the Philadelphia police commissioner, is with us. Our CNN special correspondent, Jamie Gangel, and our senior justice correspondent, Evan Perez. So, Dana, how incredible is this reporting? And you just heard Jonathan Martin's excellent reporting that the Senate Majority Leader, soon to be the Minority Leader, Mitch McConnell, is pleased that the Democrats are moving ahead to impeach the President of the United States, and that McConnell himself might actually vote in favor of conviction.
Mitch McConnell is not somebody who emotes in public, and what we saw, the anger with which he spoke, not once but twice on January 6th, before the riots and the attack effectively on him and all of his colleagues, not to mention the building that they work in, he was incredibly angry. Another byproduct of that is the fact that his wife, Elaine Chao, who was President Trump's transportation secretary, she resigned. Now, you could argue maybe she should have stayed and tried to coordinate other cabinet members to push the 25th Amendment, but she decided to quit. But with regard to Mitch McConnell, as Phil said, he has not, my understanding and our colleagues as well, he has not spoken to President Trump since Mitch McConnell acknowledged the reality that Joe Biden would be president back in December. And it was Trump who wouldn't take McConnell's phone calls, even and especially when the stimulus bill that was supposed to be signed in and around Christmas, the president decided that he wasn't going to do it and there was so much drama. McConnell couldn't even get the president on the phone, is my understanding. One last thing that I think is interesting in terms of the politics of this is that what Phil Mattingly and Manu Raju are hearing is that, and Jonathan Martin said this too, that McConnell is seeing this as a way to purge Trump from the party. I'm hearing the opposite from some of Mitch McConnell's Republican colleagues, that they are concerned that impeachment will make him a victim, will make him a martyr. So those are very two different ways of looking at Donald Trump politically and a potential impeachment conviction.
Jamie, the Times also is reporting that the House Minority Leader has asked other Republicans whether he should call on President Trump to actually resign. Could all of this give Republicans cover to vote in favor of impeaching the president when it comes up for a vote, presumably tomorrow?
Absolutely. I think what we're seeing here with this reporting about Mitch McConnell and some others coming forward is that may prove to be the tipping point. You're seeing Liz Cheney, Congresswoman from Wyoming. She has not said how she's going to vote tomorrow. But if you look at her Twitter feed, she posted something the morning of January 6th. And there's one line which I think reflects how she's feeling and a lot of other people are feeling in the Republican Party. She wrote, "We have sworn an oath under God to defend the Constitution. We uphold that oath at all times, not only when it is politically convenient." I will tell you, Wolf, the thing that I've heard over and over, I know Dana has heard this, that the Republicans experienced this full personally. They were there. They felt their lives were, that they were in danger. And we've just seen a growing number of them privately say that Trump should be impeached. I think what we're going to see tomorrow is more and more.
I suspect you're absolutely right. You know, Evan, today, and this was another breathtaking moment, the FBI and the Department of Justice, they laid out the scope of all the crimes stemming from last week's deadly siege on the U.S. Capitol. Just the fact that they're pursuing, for example, sedition and conspiracy charges, that is really significant, isn't it?
It really is, Wolf. And I think that is part of the conversation that will color, perhaps, what the Republicans in the Senate are going to be looking at. Just to what Jamie and what Dana were talking about, you know, if you have people being brought up on charges that accuse them of being of sedition and conspiracy, which is what Michael Sherwin, the acting U.S. attorney, says he's now assigned a team, a task force of prosecutors and federal agents to look into, to try to see, to pursue that possibility. 170 cases that they already have open. They anticipate there are going to be hundreds of cases. And I'll read you just a part of what the federal law on sedition says. It says that it is a crime for two or more people within the jurisdiction of the United States to oppose by force the authority of the United States government to prevent, hinder, or delay by force the execution of any law of the United States. That is what happened at the Capitol last Wednesday. These were people who were hell-bent on preventing the certification. This is a solemn part of the transition of power in this country. Urged on by the president, they marched over there, they invaded the building, destroyed offices, and they were trying to disrupt and prevent the certification of Joe Biden's victory. And that is a big deal in terms of federal law. And that's the reason why the prosecutors are looking at this in that way. And again, this may color the what happens in the Senate, because they'll you know, perhaps they'll have some more information to go on.
Yeah, and the D.C. Attorney General announced today that they're looking at possible crimes, not just by the president, but his son, Donald Trump Jr., Rudy Giuliani, Representative Mo Brooks, and others, for what they said in the minutes before that mob left the area near the White House, marched up Pennsylvania Avenue, and stormed into the U.S. Capitol. So that we're watching as well. Chief Ramsey is with us. Chief Ramsey, how difficult is an investigation like this? They're looking to bring charges against literally hundreds of people who clearly committed crimes when they stormed into the Capitol.
Well, it's difficult because it's going to take so much time to go through all the video and photographs and all the evidence that they've collected to be able to identify the individuals responsible for breaching security at the U.S. Capitol on the 6th. And so it's going to take a lot of time. I'm sure they have many, many agents combing through all the evidence, but that's what makes it difficult. And then, of course, the prosecutors have to review all the evidence and decide which charge would be most appropriate for that individual. So it's going to take some time.
Yeah, and we heard today from the U.S. attorney, the acting U.S. attorney here in D.C., as well as the top FBI agent saying they're willing to go as long, not just weeks or months, maybe longer. They want to arrest a lot of people. That's Michael Sherwin, the acting U.S. attorney. and Stephen Antuono from the FBI. He was there as well. And they were very, very determined to get to the bottom of this, a truly unprecedented moment when American citizens stormed the U.S. Capitol. These weren't foreign terrorists or anything like that. These were American citizens who clearly had been inspired to do so by the top political leadership, including the President of the United States.